have the great honor of introducing the founder of this symposium and my partner, somebody who I've been honored to have as a mentor for the last 20 years, somebody who has mastered every topic, including this one on satisfying your clients, Mr. Marcy Graham.
I feel like I'm the lucky one today because, first of all, I get to speak on a subject that I'm passionate about. And it's also a subject that I think could be helpful to all of you, because all of you, as recent, some of you, a couple of you here are in law school, but all of you are young lawyers. And all of you have the same desire and the hope for success that some of us who are a bit older had when we were back in the position you're in. And I can tell you that the subject I want to talk about is the roadway to success. We want, in fact, this symposium was developed with the idea of trying to help young lawyers develop habits, the skills, and the attributes that will make them successful. And that's our hope here today, that some of these ideas, some of the things that we talk about will be helpful to you on your roadway to success. But I want to talk about one aspect of what I think is vitally important. All of you are qualified. All of you are well-educated. The difference that I've observed in the lawyers who achieve that success beyond expectation is their ability and client relations. And it's not a journey. It's not a destination. It's a journey. It's something you do with all of your life. The key to your success is client relations. And effective client relations involves several things. First of all, it's a choice. We either choose to be good at it, or we choose not to be very good at it. It's really an art. It's much like developing the ability to give a closing argument. None of those lawyers who are going to speak to you here today were as good at giving a closing argument early in their career as they were later in their career. It's an art. And it's continually an innovative art where you learn skills as you go along. And I'm going to suggest some things to you, and I want to make a disclaimer. Some of the things that I'm going to suggest to you may sound a bit maybe hokey or contrived, but they're not. Because I can tell you that the skills that we develop to develop good and effective communications with our client, and most importantly, from our client to us, are important. The better relationship clients have with us and that we have with clients, the more successful we're going to be on behalf of those clients. Now, what are the critical times in a client relationship? Well, obviously, first contact. I'm going to talk more about that than anything. But even beyond that, during the relationship, during the entire relationship, and then finally, the completion of the relationship, and we say, well, that's everything, and that's exactly right. From the time that you start that first contact with the client until that contact and that relationship is ended, those are the critical times. First impressions are either positive or negative. There are absolutely no neutral first impressions. Okay, now I'm just going to tell you some things that I've found effective over the years. Some of them may work for you, some of them may not. Let me tell you some things that I believe are very effective in developing that really positive first impression with a client. The first time they come to your office, the first time you've met them, and the first time they've met you. I like to alert Aaron, who's out front in our office, that Mr. and Mrs. Jones are coming in this evening. They're going to be at 11 o'clock this morning. Because that way, when Mr. and Mrs. Jones get there, they can say, "This is Mr. and Mrs. Jones, see Mr. Graham." And she can say, "Oh, Mr. and Mrs. Jones, Mr. Graham is expecting you. Please be seated and I'll get you part of it." In other words, if that client comes to the office and they know that they're being expected, it starts things off better. When I go to the doctor's office a lot, I go in, I say, I'm Marcy Graham, I'm here to see Dr. So-and-so. They say, well, you sign in here and tell the time, put the time down and sit down. Very impersonal. The more personal you make it, the better it is to get started. Be on time. Nobody wants to wait, so we need to be able to schedule our time so the clients don't have to wait too long to see us. Sometimes we can't avoid it. If we're going to be late, if we're 15 or 20 minutes late and being able to talk to the client, the first thing we need to do is to apologize for it. I like to go out and meet clients in the waiting room. Actually go out to them, shake hands, make sure you get the names right, but meet them out there and then escort them to a conference room. Listen, I want to talk a lot about names, but listen carefully to the names. If a lady's name is Marion, don't start calling her Mary. Really pay attention. And the same thing, I'll give a good example. I talked to Philip earlier, but he goes by Phil. So I asked him, I said, is it Philip or Phil? He says, I go by Phil. So that way I can call him what he's normally called by and not get mixed up. So sometimes it's important to talk to your clients. How do you go by? What do you prefer to be called? Sometimes we see, particularly now, we see clients who have foreign names. And I think it's important to talk to that client and say, now look, I want to make sure I'm pronouncing your name correctly. Tell me now how to pronounce your name. I want to do it during this relationship. Make sure you get that pronunciation down. As soon as that client encounter is over, go back and write it down. I write it down phonetically, but make sure you have the names right. I think it's good to visit just briefly at the outset. And one of the reasons I like to do that, first of all, almost every client, when they come to you, maybe not so much if you're a defense lawyer, you've got a claims person in, and they're kind of used to this, but most clients are really nervous. So I think it's good to kind of break the ice initially. I like to find out a lot about the family and their background, where you grew up. Tell me about your family. And most, but not all, of the people that come to us have children, or brothers or sisters. And if you find out that the family has a daughter who plays soccer, and they went to the state soccer championship, those are notes. After the first meeting with the client is over, you'll make notes in the file, either written notes or in the computer. So the next time that those clients come back in, whether it's a week later or a month later, you can say, oh, by the way, we talked last time about your daughter playing soccer and she was going to a tournament. How did the tournament work out? What you're doing there is you're telling the client how important they are to you because you remember things about them. So I think it's really good to break the ice, and it's also helpful to them because that way they're more comfortable when you start talking about the real reasons they're there. So break the ice with them before you jump right into it. I think it's important to be able to control the meeting. Some clients are very, very reluctant to talk, and you have to really work with them. Some clients won't shut up. I mean, you just can't find a way to shut them up. So there are ways, I think, that you can develop skills to it at the time that after a half hour, an hour, whatever it's taken, you can develop the skill to say, look, I know you've got other things to do. The last thing you want to do is spend a lot of time with an attorney today. And so here's what we're going to do. And you tell them what you're going to do and what they need to do. We're going to talk about in a minute, but develop skills to be able to make the meeting productive, but not go beyond that. Very important, whether you're a sole practitioner or with the one secretary or a big firm, introduce the client to the team. That's your secretary, a paralegal, if you work with a paralegal, another lawyer, if you work with another lawyer. It really sends a good message for a client to understand that they're working with a team. You may be the leader, you may be the point person, but you're part of a team, and the client is a part of the team. In fact, I typically will say, and I want you to be members of the team that's going to be working on your behalf. And I'll say, at some point, and understand that you are an important part of this team. I think if you build that team concept, and that they're a part of the team, you send a good message, and also I think it makes for a more productive relationship. I like to have an agenda. I prepare an agenda for almost every first meeting. This would happen to be an agenda for a client that comes in and is going to talk about a personal injury case, in this case, the plaintiff's. First of all, we have a general discussion, then we talk about the issues, and then I start talking about some of the things that might be important to explain to them about the case that they have. Let me talk about venue, statutes of limitations, burden of proof, damages, always in that first meeting with the client, talk about fees. A lot of clients are reluctant to bring up fees. Some of them are scared to death about what it's going to cost them. And so bring up fees. I mean, if it's a contingent fee case, that's a little easier because they probably know how those attorneys work on contingent fee cases. But if you're in the trust and estate practice or the corporation practice or in some type of office practice, then they're going to want to know how much is it going to cost them. So you bring up the fees and they'll bring a sigh of relief that they didn't have to bring it up themselves. Have documents ready. If you're going to need medical authorizations or work authorizations or whatever you're going to need, have those ready for them when they get there. Then you need to talk about risk. You talk about, you know, sometimes things don't go as well as we want them to, so you need to talk about risk. Need to talk about timelines. You know, clients are always dismayed to learn how long some of these things take. So you can talk about a timeline and eliminate unreasonable expectations. Talk about the possibility of settlement, possibility of mediation. And then get some questions and answers. Say, now look, I've tried to cover everything, but you probably have some questions. And let's go over your questions now. Don't let a client leave your office that first time unless you've addressed all of their questions. And this last one, 14. I can't believe more strongly, this gets back to that team approach, I can't believe more strongly that when that client leaves your office for the first time, they need to have an assignment. Something that they've got to do, whether it's to gather tax returns, whether it's to give you a list of every employer they've had since getting out of high school. Whatever it is that you're going to need, give them an assignment and give them a time to get it back. It emphasizes that team approach, but it also gets them accustomed to working with you so that things can progress in the manner and at the speed you want. Okay, again, talking about that initial client contact after we address the agenda. Give clients undivided attention. I would suggest that none of us ever take a phone call during a client meeting. Okay, having said that, if you get a call that a kid's sick at school, then obviously that's different. If a judge calls, that's different. Here's how I handle judge calls. If the secretary tells me that Judge so-and-so is calling me, I will tell the client, look, a judge is calling me, or Judge so-and-so is calling me. I'm going to step out and take that call, and I'll be back as soon as I can. I think you can do that way. And try to, you know, you may even have to explain to the judge, I've got a client, I want to get rid of the judge and see what's going on. Anyway, handle it any way you want. But never take, unless it's an emergency, a call from another client in front of a client, and particularly to discuss anything with that client. Because all of a sudden the client thinks, wait a minute, he's talking to a client on the phone in front of me about my case, his case. And so I suppose he might do the same thing about my case in front of another client if they're here when I call. So it's I think it's bad practice to do anything but give the client undivided attention. In the old days, we always met, you know, behind our office desk, and the client was out in front of us. I think the best idea and setting for a client meeting is around the conference table. I think most of us do that now, but not all of us. It's the old kind of kitchen table philosophy. I think the communications are healthier if you're all sitting around. I think if the lawyer's behind his desk and the clients are out here, it's a bit more intimidating and a little less equality. But if you're all sitting around the table together, I think the engagement is better, the communication is healthier, and it's more productive. So I would always suggest using conference table. If you have a round table, that's even better. You talked about not taking phone calls. It's important for clients to understand how your office works. Make sure when they leave your office after that first visit, they know who to call for an appointment, they have all of the contact information, that they have maybe a backup person to call if they can't get the first person that they would call to arrange for an appointment or a conference call. Make sure they know how your office works, and you've already introduced them to the team. I think it's good to have business cards. I like the paralegal that works with me, the secretary, Terry, that works with me. She has her own business cards, and I make sure the client has those business cards when they leave, so they know, they remember the name, they have the numbers, and again, that's another emphasis of the fact that they're represented by a team. We talked about explaining fee arrangements early, and there has to be some discussion about exactly what the client is expecting and what they want. And that's going to take some time, usually, to make sure you've asked enough questions and gotten enough responses that you know what the client wants. Continuing, it's good to take notes, and it's just better than memory. So sometimes it's difficult to talk and take notes. So frequently, if you have a secretary and she's available, I know that Warren Cole does this on a regular basis, and some of our other lawyers do, have the secretary there and have her principally be the one that's taking the notes. That's something you just have to work out for yourself, whatever's the better choice for you, but that is something to consider. Particularly as a young lawyer, sometimes we're so excited about the client that we can unintentionally create unreasonable expectations. So that's why it's important, number one, find out what the client's expectations are and to make sure we discuss with them the possibilities of achieving those expectations, but also the risk of achieving those expectations. And that doesn't just occur in the litigation setting. You know, people come to, I suspect we have some lawyers here who don't do much litigation but have an office practice and do wills and trusts and estates and incorporate. And so some of these decisions that have to be made about incorporating or a will or a trust involve determining whether the estate's large enough to divide to take advantage of some tax, estate tax issues by dividing the estate. There may be some important dates in which documents have to be signed by. There may be a need to look at tax returns before you can make certain decisions. So a lot of what we need to do is to make sure we have the right information to explain to them the decisions that have to be made and some of the risks that might exist with some of those decisions. So explaining things can be wrong. We've talked about creating a partnership and always give them things to do. And when in addition to giving the client something to do, always end a client meeting, every meeting, with the summary. This is what we've talked about. Now, this is what I'm going to do. This is what I need for you to do. And these are the dates we're anticipating doing depositions. And we're going to try to get those set at a time that's convenient to you or convenient to your family. So just summarize everything we've talked about in the meeting so that they understand that. Clients forget, trust me, clients forget. We've talked about developing the ability to end a client conference. And sometimes it's just as simple as I said before, look, I know you've got other things to do. I want to get to work on this as soon as I can. And be sure to give Terry a call when I contact you next time to set an appointment. Remember, manners matter. Don't sit there and drink your Diet Coke if you haven't offered them a soda or water. I'm going to the lawyer's office. I'm met with lawyers. So they sit there and drink their Diet Coke or their coffee and never offer me the same. It's important to exercise the same good manners that we would with a friend or a family member with our clients. And when the client leaves, do something that sounds so simple, but is so important. Tell the client, look, I know this is important to you, and I want to thank you for trusting me to handle this for you. Thank you. It'll surprise them, and it'll make them feel better. What clients should leave with? When they leave at the first meeting, first of all, if we've handled it the way that we should handle it, we want them to leave with confidence and trust that they've chosen the right lawyer for them. We want them to know definitely that they're part of the team. They're part of a team, and that their participation is really important. We want them to leave with reasonable and not unreasonable expectations. We want them to understand that there may be risk and there may be problems. And we want them to know the contact person that they need to contact in the event they need to get with us. Now, if you really want to irritate a client or run them off, I can give you some ways to do it. That's what we're going to do now. Failing to keep the clients updated and informed. A number of years ago, I was on the advisory committee to the Supreme Court, and one of the most frequent complaints, written complaints, that came to the Office of Chief Disciplinary Counsel was that lawyers would not get back with their clients. Clients that they've already taken on as a client, maybe taken a retainer, maybe had been paid fees, but they wouldn't get back with their clients. Failing to return phone calls. All of us are busy, and that's one of the challenges we have. But some lawyers I know have a really good practice of, you know, somewhere around 4:15 to 5 or 5:30, make sure that all of their telephone calls and now their emails are returned. Because if you wait too long, it becomes just almost an impossibility. So I think that's one of the biggest challenges that we as lawyers have. And it's one of the challenges that we've got to find a way to deal with successfully and promptly. And that is returning phone calls and responding to emails from clients. It's important clients worry about these. It's one of the ways that lawyers can really fall into a trap and send out a bill and a client says, I had no idea it was going to cost this much. If I knew it was going to cost this, I wouldn't have come to you. I wouldn't have done this. Got to be upfront about fees. Unreasonable expectations can really create some problems with a client. Also, you know, clients want to know that they've hired the right person. And I think it's important that we share with them our experience in certain areas. But we need to be careful not to brag about doing this or to brag about we've appeared in front of this judge a lot. We really know this judge a lot. He knows, or she knows us real well. That gets over into an area, if you've got a halfway smart client, they wonder, you know, why is he or why is she telling you this? So it's important to share our experience, but it's important also not to get into the area where it looks like we have an advantage with a certain judge or with a certain lawyer. Talked about not engaging in the practices of discourtesy. We don't want them to leave our office thinking that we haven't exercised good manners or have been discourteous. We talked about client confidentiality, about the telephone calls. One reason I like to meet in a conference room is because of the fact that on my desk, and I suspect 90% of you here is true on your desk, you have office files for other clients. And the likelihood of this happening is minimal, but it does happen. Because our client files, and I suspect your client files, have names. Mary Smith versus John Smith, the divorce case. Whatever, maybe it's any kind of claim, a boundary dispute, a road dispute, a contract dispute, somebody's being sued for not paying their bill, paying their credit card. And if a client looks over there and sees that, first of all, that Mary Smith is suing John Smith, and that's the same family they go to church with on Sunday, they didn't know that until they saw that file. First of all, it's a violation of the ethics rules, the confidentiality, and also it's really bad business because what you're communicating, what we're communicating if we meet with clients where they can see other clients' files, they're saying, well, I don't guess they're going to keep my case quiet either. So I don't think we should ever meet with a client where other clients' files are visible. It's just not a good idea. This has happened, I know, to some of you. All of a sudden, you get a hearing, and you're running a little bit late, you're busy, and you call a client 2 days ahead of a hearing where they're going to be there for something, maybe a whatever, and you give them a couple of 3 days' notice. Sometimes that's unavoidable, but that's seldom. First we know that a client's going to have to be in court, or have to be in a deposition, or have to be available for an IME, anything that they've got to have to do with the case, we need to notify them immediately, give them as much notice as we can. It's just bad practice not to do that. And that really involves staff help and making sure that once we know of our clients need to be somewhere, or be available, or come in and work with them, interrogatory answers, so we don't have to file for a bunch of extra time to do that. We need to notify them properly. Okay. Some of you maybe have not dealt with this, but I suspect that some of you have. Sometimes we get involved with clients that it just goes badly. It's not going to happen often, but sometimes the chemistry is just not good. You can tell you're not happy with the client. They're not happy with you. The lines of communication have gone bad, and you wish they would never have gotten involved. If that happens, we've got a Supreme Court rule, 1.16, that says if we're going to get out of a case, if we're going to withdraw, we have to do it consistent with the rules. And to do that, we have to do it timely, so we don't disadvantage the client. So be careful. If you're going to have to get out of a case, get out early. Don't wait until the client might be disadvantaged. Two ideas to leave you with. Again, call clients at unusual times. Most of us work late. Some of us come in on the weekends. It doesn't hurt to give a couple of clients a call just on the weekend to ask them about something, inquire about the days. See what's going on. What you're telling them is, number one, she's working on my case on the weekend. Secondly, they cared enough about me to call me during unusual hours. We talked about this before. No one gets used to names and background information to enhance quality of client relationship. I am a big believer in index cards. And I carry index cards with me all the time, because I like to write down people's names and information. For instance, Bill, I know he's got 3-month-old Nathan. And I know that because we were talking a while ago and he mentioned that. Well, next time I see Phil, I'll have this on the computer and I'll be able to ask him about Nathan. I know Brittany's from Perryville. And Perryville's a town near where I came from. We were talking earlier. She went to school at TMO and then went over to Carbondale for law school. And now is up here. Worked with the Sandberg Phoenix. And now is over at the Mikroslav firm doing school. I know that because I wrote it down. I'll have that. Next time I see Brittany, I'll be able to talk about something that I know about her. So it's important. This, and this is the way you develop clients. When you're a church, when you're a school board, PTA, develop this circle of potential clients that you know about. So when you see them the next time, you can ask them about their vacation to Hawaii. You can ask them about the time that they had to wait for 4 hours at the airport. Just any little information that tells them, hey, they care enough about me to remember me. Okay, now a little bit of a segue. We talked about client relations, but there's also, I think, something I always like to end with. You know, the business that we're in, the profession we're in, that of practicing law, is very demanding. It's demanding time-wise. And I think we do have some other obligations, clearly, that we have to think about. And that is balancing our lives. And you as young lawyers are going to be challenged by that because you're busy. And you're going to get busy. And so, you have family obligations and community obligations. Years ago, I wrote in the Bar Journal that it matters a little if we're a success as a lawyer, but then fail as a spouse or a parent. And that's one of the biggest challenges that we deal with, is balancing that life. Also, we have an obligation in the profession. It's even written in the rules. We have an obligation to practice at a level of professionalism that enhances the reputation of the legal profession, the administration of lawyers, the administration of justice, and lawyers in general. Now, 1977, Bates versus Arizona. Up until 77, advertising was not permitted. Bates made it permissible as a First Amendment right of commercial free speech. And I think in St. Louis, we really have good advertising. I don't present this as because it's bad advertising, in my opinion, but I think it's saying this lawyer doesn't care a whole lot about what people think about the profession.
Pennsylvania, and I stand ready, willing, able, and committed to defend you on all manner of criminal charges, including murder, arson, burglary, bank robbery, simple and aggravated assault, and possibly even funny throwback crimes such as moonshining or pickpocketing. You're charged with serious criminal offense, and you're facing the fight of your life. You need a lawyer who understands you and understands where you're coming from. Trust me, I may have a law degree, but I think like a criminal. Criminal defense attorneys around town are going to take your money and then blow That's not me. I pick up the phone, I answer calls, I return letters, and I make jail visits. Because I'll probably be there visiting my friends anyways. I'm a Pittsburgh criminal defense attorney. Pittsburgh criminals hire when they commit crimes. I'm also licensed to practice in every single county in the Commonwealth. So don't feel left out, people in Beaver, Mercer, Crawford, Venango, or even Lehigh County. I'll go anywhere. Any criminal defense attorney who promises you a result is most likely a liar or a scumbag. But what I can promise you is my committed fighting effort to ensure that you are adequately defended on any charge that you're facing. Pay me now, thank me later. Remember, you keep your trap shut, and I'll keep your trap open.
We haven't gotten any money from advertisers like that, but getting back before I introduce someone I want to bring to you to tell you about a real opportunity, I want to close with this thought. And over the years, I've learned the truth of this. Clients don't care how much we know until they know how much we care. Once they learn that we are committed to efforts on their behalf, once they know that they're important to us, then that relationship is a useful relationship, helps us do a better job for them, is more designed to get them what they want, and also is designed to make the administration of justice our part working for them work well. So the client doesn't care how much we know until they know how much we care.